Okay. Well, hopefully everybody can hear me. I'd like to thank all of you for coming to today's webinar. This is the second in the new series on astrophysics empowered by the EHT. And there will be more. And I just encourage everyone to check the schedule and register for future webinars. So Rosie or someone has just put the webinar schedule link in the chat. You can find the past webinars on YouTube on the Black Hole Pyre Science channel. And we have a link to that in the chat as well. Today, our webinar, as the previous webinars, is going to last for 1 hour, including question time. So one thing that we encourage you to do as part of the Pyre is to help us improve the future webinars. And we're going to ask you to complete a very short survey at the end. It takes 2 minutes. So we'd be really grateful if you did that. All right, so today we're going to ask everyone to turn off their audio so we don't have any background noise, and turn off your video, please, to improve bandwidth. We just ask that you add your questions to the chat window, and either CK or I will handle the questions from there. All right, so today's webinar. So it's a pleasure to introduce my friend and collaborator, CK Chan. He's a lead of the EHT computational and data processing efforts, and he's an assistant astronomer at the University of Arizona Stewart Observatory. So CK has worked in many areas, but among his contributions, he's developed new algorithms to study turbulent plasmas around black holes. He's been a leader in the use of GPUs to accelerate the kind of work that he's going to be talking about today. And he's also been a leader in building a cloud computing infrastructure for big observational data sets, especially for EHT, and applying machine learning algorithms to speed up and automate data processing. All right, so without further ado, over to you, CK.
Thank you very much, Charles. Can people hear me fine? Okay, so today's topic is on ray tracing. So this is a relatively simple problem, but this is very important because it's at the interface of theory and observation. I guess everyone on this webinar has seen this image before. This is the an image of M87 from the Event Horizon Telescope. Pyre actually has a webinar series last semester on how the EHT gather data, process the data, and reconstruct image for something like this. Now for today, I will focus on the theory side. You're getting the image is only the first step in our science. We really want to learn something about gravity, astrophysics, around black hole. So in order to do that, the first thing is we need to have a theory of gravity. So the best theory of gravity we have so far is general relativity. There will be a Pyre webinar on that later on. And once we have general relativity ready, we assume a black hole space-time, and we put fluid dynamics on top of that. And we also allow magnetic field to evolve with the fluid. That gives us general relativistic magneto hydrodynamics. So Charles actually covered this 2 weeks ago and tell us how to solve this very nonlinear problem numerically. Now, once we have the fluid description of the plasma around black hole, we actually need to put in plasma physics and thermodynamics, because this will tell us how the electrons behave in the accretion flow. And once we have all of these different physics ready, we can finally put in ray tracing to turn the physics into image. And if we do this whole thing well, the physics on the top half of this slice, they belong to this black hole accretion physics that Ramesh gave a very good overview earlier this semester. We want our physical understanding going through ray tracing to come up with an image that is similar and comparable to EHT observation. And doing this, we can learn fundamental physics about space-time. We can learn the plasma physics around black hole and many, many interesting things. Now, however, I should point out that even before the EHT, we actually had a lot of observations on black hole. So these are only two examples that I'm pulling out from some of the prior partners. So on the left, this is a model of Sagittarius A star, so the supermassive black hole at the center of our Milky Way galaxy. So these are really the points here, the circles and the arrows here. These are observational data points of radio and infrared flux. Okay, and Faria in 2002, she models if we have non-thermal electrons, which I will cover later, in this accretion flow around Sagittarius A star, how they will affect the spectral distribution and how they will affect our interpretation of the black hole. Now, on the more higher energy side, on the X-ray, there are also a lot of observations. The examples I give you here is was done by Dimitri Sauter in 1999. This is something called X-ray timing. So NASA actually has spacecraft that monitor X-ray binary stellar mass black hole. And once we process how this X-ray vary, we can see these very distinct features called the quasi-periodic oscillations. So the frequency is at the kilohertz scale. So this corresponding to the innermost accretion flow. Now, however, the physical origin of this QPO is still actively researched area. It's not fully resolved yet. Okay, so for this type of picture, the black hole is not resolved. There are only a single pixel, a single point in the data set. Okay, the very exciting thing comes from the Event Horizon Telescope. When we use many radio telescopes around the world to do interferometry, trying to observe the black hole. So this is the map showing the EHT array. We have telescope all around the world. In 2017, we have 8 telescopes, and in 2018 and in the future, we will have more telescopes. So each pair of the telescope that gives us a baseline, the longer the baseline it is, we are able to resolve finer features of the black hole. And with the limited size of the Earth and the radio wavelength we are working on, we are able to resolve the event horizon of two supermassive black holes on the sky. One is M87, the orange donut that everyone saw. The other one is Sagittarius A star, again, the supermassive black hole at the center of our Milky Way. Okay, so we want our theoretical understanding and numerical simulation to create movies like something on the left, and we want to compare this with observation, something like on the right. So how do we do that? For a single pixel models like the X-ray that I showed you earlier, you can just do it even analytically. But for something like this, we need to do it numerically. The method we use is called general relativistic ray tracing. So there are really two parts of that. The first part is we need to follow the lines in curved space-time. So this comes from general relativity. So on the right here, I have a cartoon showing you the basic concept of this. If the space-time is flat, if there's no massive object around, then your particles, photons, they will just move in straight line in this flat space-time. Now, if you introduce a heavy object, the heavy object will bend the space-time according to Einstein's general relativity. And then even the particles and photons, they want to move in the most straight line in this curved space-time, they will appear to be curved. So the first step of general general relativistic ray tracing is to follow this curved space time, follow these geodesics. So let me show you another demonstration of this. So let's think about a thought experiment that you have a black hole and you are shining a flashlight to it. So what happens is the light, you know, the photons, some of them will actually go around the black hole and come back to you. So when you look at this experiment, you will see a light ring around you. Now the middle dark part, that's what the UHT usually refer as the black hole shadow. And then there is a light ring around that. So this ring corresponds to your orange ring we see in the M87 image. Okay, so this is another graphics to show how ray tracing works. We start at image far away from the black hole, but near the observer. At each pixel of that image, we follow the geodesic. We follow the path of the light going back to the accretion flow around the black hole. On the front ground here, this is a volume rendering of a GL-MHD simulation that Charles showed us 2 weeks ago. And if your ray is far away from the black hole, then they only bend slightly. You don't get a lot of deformation in your image. Now, however, if your pixel corresponds to a ray that is near the black hole, they could orbit around the black hole and then they can give you the distinguished features in the image. Okay, so just a couple of equations because I assume people listening to this webinar will be interested in doing ray tracing themselves. So the principle is very, very simple. You can derive the geodesic equation from the action principle. So what you really want to do is you integrate the light element, the path of your geodesics, and this is your action. And then you try to minimize this action and then you will automatically derive the geodesic equations. Okay, so X here is the fault location. Gamma here is the Christoffel symbol. For people who study general relativity, I'm sure you remember the form of the Christoffel symbol. But one trick I want to tell people is if you need to do your exam quick enough in time, it's actually easier to just write down the equation directly from the action principle instead of just memorizing the terms. Now, for our purpose, it's actually more convenient to write the geodesic equation in terms of the derivative of the position. So I denote it as U here, and you will see this equation later in this talk. Okay, so general relativistic ray tracing is not new. There's a long history on that. And in fact, the thought experiment I showed you that come from Bardeen, it was in the 70s. And there are a lot more work has been done since then. So this is a table of some of the GRRT codes that I'm aware of. I want to highlight a few codes. So first I want to highlight GR Monty and GO Kurt from Charles Group and also Jason Dester. So I think they are really the foundational work for the modern era of ray tracing because both of these codes are open source. So in addition to the paper, the code itself is open. So anyone can read that, learn from them, and that really spawns this whole wave of development in ray tracing. And also I want to highlight some contribution from my group. So I believe we are the first team who use GPU to accelerate ray tracing, and that allow us to generate many, many more image a few years ago. So I think that's also very, very important in this development. Okay, so I also want to highlight that since we have so many codes, one very important thing is we want to compare them to make sure all the different codes we use in the Event Horizon Telescope project are consistent. So there is actually a code comparison led by Roman Gold. This is just two figures showing that for the ray tracing part, all the codes are consistent with each other. And actually the biggest difference in this different code is how you set up the camera. some people set up the camera farther away. Some people do semi-analytically integrate the ray to a location. So it's that small difference that lead to this difference in the test. But the ray tracing itself is very well established. Okay, and again, for this webinar, I think it's good to show people not just everything that people will highlight in the normal talks. So I actually want to tell people some of the difficulty you may face in doing ray tracing. So most of these ray tracing code, when they solve the geodesic equations, they use the Boyer Lindquist coordinate. So there is a coordinate singularity at the pole of the black hole. And there are different ways to handle that singularity. You can just set up the pixel to avoid the singularity, so you never hit that. You can use adaptive stepping. So when you get close to the pole, you use smaller step. So our experience is, if we want to have some photon go through the pole directly, even if you use adaptive stepping, you will still get problems. So the dotted line in the left panel here, this is actually a bad photon that hit the pole when we do the integration. So if you look into this into the detail, then what happens is, when you're using a high order numerical scheme to integrate the photons, you will have multiple sub-steps. And when your sub-step actually land on the different quarter of the coordinate system, the error doesn't cancel each other. And then you will have this kind of crazy behavior. The photon will just get kicked out to almost infinity from the pole. So in the G-ray code, our resolution is, when you have a bad photon like that, we just fall back to a first order Euler stepping with a much smaller time step to go through the pole, because there's no sub step. So you can just go through the pole without problem. So this is one of the tiny details that you may face if you want to do ray tracing yourself. I mentioned GPU acceleration a couple of times already. GPU, the special computer hardware, originally designed to accelerate computer graphics, but they turns out to be very good in doing floating point operation, and they are very good for high performance computing. And in fact, almost all the fastest supercomputer in the world today, they use GPUs to accelerate their computation. So our contribution here is we turn a pretty standard ray tracing code to GPU using the CUDA platform from NVIDIA. So this is some benchmark. The pink and the yellow lines, they are from standard codes. Then you can see, if you have a small number of photons, they are still pretty fast. But when you have a large number of photons, when you want to simulate a high resolution image, then they start to become slow. And the bullish line here, this is from our GPU code. So initially, because of how the GPU works, it actually require a lot of computation to run efficiently. So if you just have a small number of photons, the GPU code is actually slower than the CPU codes. But once you go to the regime of high resolution image, then the GPU code can be about 30 times faster than older techniques. So this is very useful when we need to do parameter study of this black hole image, and they also make great movies. Okay, so I mentioned that GPU is fast. So let me show you this video that we took a while ago. So what we are doing here is we are running the G-ray code in real time, and I'm using my hand and a controller called Leap Motion to control this simulation in real time. So each point here is a photon. We were integrating a quarter million photons in real time, and we can interact with that. Okay. So and if you're careful, you may see when I integrate the photons backward in time, there's actually a hole in this sheet of photon. So that also corresponds to the black hole shadow that we talked about earlier. Okay. Yeah, so you know, this is super cool to play with interactive ray tracing code. Okay, so you know, I mentioned the shadow a few times already. So it turns out that general relativity has a very distinguished signature of the black hole shadow. So no matter what spin of the black hole is, and no matter what inclination you have, the black hole shadow is pretty circular. So this gives you a null test on general relativity. So what that really means is, you know, if in the EHT we observe something that is unlike a circle, then we can, you know, make a statement that your general relativity is probably not right. And then, you know, more recently, there is a paper from the EHT collaboration led by Dimitrios Sotis, who make this test more qualitative. And the statement there is you can use the size of the black hole shadow to make constraint on general relativity. Okay, but I won't go into the detail of that. So you know, so far I went through the ray tracing part. So this is the first half of you know, the physics we need to compute the black hole image. The second half is radiative transfer. Once we get the geodesics, we actually need to integrate the radiative transfer equation along the geodesics in order to get the intensity of that pixels. So you know, so here again, a couple equations, because I assume people will want to do things themselves. So let's start with the standard long relativistic radiative transfer equation. So you know, many of you probably learned this in an undergraduate you know, astronomy class. So I is the intensity as a function of frequency nu here, and S here is the path length. So I'm just thinking about time independent radiative transfer now. Alpha here is the absorption coefficient. So when you are following your geodesic along a plasma, your emissivity, your radiation can be absorbed by the plasma. So you have a minus sign of alpha here that take away your radiation. But in addition to that, you can have emission from the plasma itself. So that is captured by J here. That's the emission coefficient. Now, sometimes it is convenient to integrate the physical path length to the optical depth. And once you do that, you can rewrite your radiative transfer equation in this form. So you become the derivative of the intensity as, you know, with respect to the opacity. And then you will have one E flow you know, with the intensity itself, because the opacity is, you know, captured in the optical depth. And then you have this source function here that is just J divided by alpha. Now this form is very useful in general relativistic ray tracing, because I, the intensity that we usually work with, that is not a Lorentz invariant. So if you want to do this in general relativity, the quantity you want to work with is actually I divided by frequency cube. So this term here, this is the Lorentz invariant intensity, is actually proportional to the photon distribution function. And then you will have similar your weighting for your absorption and emission coefficient, and they are denoted by chi and eta here. And now if you put this term into this form of the weighted transfer equation, then it becomes, you know, this form here. So this is the Lorentz invariant radiative transfer equation that you can use when you do general relativistic ray tracing. You know, of course, you know, you can just integrate this numerically, but at least when you just deal with intensity, it's more convenient to use integration factor to pull the optical depth out as a function of a fine parameter that you will also use in your geodesic integrator. And now you can integrate the optical depth together with your geodesic, And you can also integrate your intensity together with your tilt asset. Another advantage of this form is you can see the opacity now become a factor here. You know, this is the reason we use the integration factor. But what this means is you can actually integrate your image backward. You don't need to go forward in time. Instead, you start with the image plane, you go backward in time and toward the black hole. And once you hit a region that is optically thick enough that you cannot see through, then this factor will become very, very small. And then you can stop your numerical integration. Okay. So let me use this your movie to describe what I mean here. This is again a simulation of black hole. So what you are seeing here is a ray trace image at some radio frequency. At this point, the accretion flow is optically thick. So you can only see the body of the accretion flow. You can also see the funnel that I will give more details later. But numerically, the integration scheme actually stops integrating when it hits this photosphere because it knows the optical depth is high there. Okay, but now if we change the frequency, we go to a shorter wavelength, higher frequency, then the accretion flow start to become transparent. Your numerical integrator will carry deeper into the accretion flow, and you can see the photosphere become smaller. And when you are at the 1.3 millimeter, that is the frequency that the EHT used to observe, then you can see through the whole plasma. And then you can have an image of the central black hole. So this is just a looping movie. So we can just wait until it go back to that location. Yes. So this is 1.3 millimeter wavelength. And at this point, the accretion flow become fully transparent. Your integration scheme will just go through the whole accretion flow. Some of them will orbit around the black hole and go through a deeper optical depth in the plasma. And that is partially the reason you see the bright ring in this image. Okay, so this is another details I want to tell some of the people who are interested in doing GPU ray tracing. So because GPU, they are designed for computer graphics, they are very good in carrying our single precision floating point operation, but they are slower in double precision that's commonly used in scientific computation. And in fact, in some of the earlier GPU model that we use, the single precision performance is almost 10 times faster than the double precision. So one technique that we derive in the GRRT code is we manage to use single precision for ray tracing. Now, and also for radiative transfer. So normally when you do radiative transfer, there are a lot of physical constants that are numerically big or small. For example, the speed of light is 10 to the 10 in CGS unit. The Planck constant, they are small. So normally if you are not careful, you shouldn't do radiative transfer in single precision because you will either overflow or underflow your computation. But you're motivated by the performance gain in the GPU. So we actually study each of our emissivity, each of the function we use in the radiative transfer very carefully. And we group the different terms and constants together so that whenever we finish a computation and save it to a variable, the range of that variable is within the limit of single precision float. And when we do computation, when we do operation, we are also very carefully grouping this operation. So for example, this F1 variable here, we multiply it by new square instead of new cube, to make sure that the numerical value won't overflow the single precision limit. So once you do this carefully, it's actually possible to do all the radiative transfer and ray tracing in single precision, and then you will get the performance gain that I mentioned earlier. Okay, So once you do all this hard work to your program your ray tracing and radiative transfer, a typical black hole image will look like something like this. So you will see the fake black hole accretion disk in the mid plane. Depending on your parameters, you may see the funnel. That is the low density and your magnetically dominated region of the accretion flow. And then you will also see a ring here that come from the photon orbiting around the black hole. So this is actually a movie. So let's you spend some time looking at this movie. So you because we are doing simulation, so we can move the camera look in any way we want. So I'm just spinning the camera up and down here. And actually, let me repeat that part. So now if you are careful and focus on the position of the photon ring, when the camera will change, the photon ring will actually shift left and right. So this is due to frame dragging. So because of the spin of the black hole, you actually shift the position of this photon ring according to the spin. So when you're swinging your camera, you will see the position change as well. Okay, another thing I want to point out that is a special feature for this model is once in a while you will see some very bright features showing up in the simulation. So let me see if I can catch that. Yes, sorry. So let me try again. So I think it was here. Here we go. So so I will give a little bit more details later, but what the features you are seeing here, they actually correspond to a very strong magnetic field. So for this particular model, we have different plasma prescription for the accretion flow based on the strength of the magnetic field. So whenever you have a strong magnetic field showing up in the accretion flow, these will got light up in these models. And they can, they are potentially able to explain some of the flare activity that we see in Sagittarius star. Okay, so I got a question that is the spin of a black hole affect the structure of photon ring? So that is a very interesting question. So normally you will think the spin of the black hole will give you the frame dragging and that will totally change how the photon ring look like. But it turns out that there is a turn cancellation there that when you spin up the black hole, the main effect that you see in the photon ring is this shift that I mentioned earlier. The shape itself, it actually doesn't change that much. And I believe that the cancellation was derived in a paper by Tim Johansson and Dimitrios Sotis in 2012, I believe. Okay, so let's see. Okay, so once we have these tools, now we can finally start to compare numerical simulations to observations. So this is a figure in my own work in 2015. There are all these cross here, they are different observations of Sagittarius A star in the radio and infrared. And we also have some data point in the X-ray. So back then, the fitting process we had was we use about 10% of the quiescent X-ray flux to constrain the models. So whatever model we put in, if you overproduce the quiescent X-ray flux by 10%, then we say the model is ruled out, okay? And then we also use the radial flux to do a fitting for the models. And you'll remember this is 2015, it was pre-EHT 2017 observation. So we didn't have an image yet, but there are some early EHT observation of Sagittarius star that give us an image size at 1.3 millimeter. So we also use the image size to constrain the model. And finally, we are also using some upper limits in this region. So let's see. So you know, with all of this, we can you know, fit multiple models to CRJ star. So I guess this is a important realization that, you know, with the observation, it's possible that there's no single model that you know, fit the data. It's possible that we have multiple fits. And but you know, with these five models, we can, with these five models, we can further study their time variability and use that to learn something about CRJ star. So this is one of our models. So we call it model B. And then we, you know, although the fitting is done on the quiescence day, we, after the fitting, we actually look at its time variability. So something very interesting thing, something very interesting actually happens. So let me go through these few panels first. So the left panel here, this is the radial image of that model. The second panel here is the 1.3 millimeter. So this is exactly the wavelength that the EHT observed. And I also have a panel for optical and X-ray. Okay, and the bottom panel here is the shows the light curve of this different frequency, and the color actually match up. So the red curve is radial, the white curve is for 1.3 millimeter, and blue is for X-ray. So within this model, we noticed that even though the fitting was done on the quiescence day, the model is able to reproduce flares, you know, this fluctuation that people actually observe in the radio and infrared. Okay, but however, the X-ray curve is very, very smooth. You don't see any flare there. Okay, and you know, because there are multiple models, we can also look at it, the time variability for a different model. So this is the model that has zero spin. So compared to the previous one, I guess one important feature is you notice that the image is now more symmetric. You know, you don't really have a one side emission anymore due to the Doppler boosting and frame tracking. Okay, but then the variability is kind of similar to the previous one, except you don't have, you know, the big flares. You have a lot of, you know, this small variability due to the turbulence in the accretion flow. So, and then we have another model. This is the MAT model. So I didn't mention this earlier, but both Ramesh and Charles mentioned this in the previous webinar. So this is the model that the magnetic field is very strong near the black hole, and they are stopping the accretion. So for this kind of models, even though they fit the quiescent data, if you look at the time variability, they are very, very different. So based on that, back at that time, we thought the MAT model was unlikely for CRJ. Okay. Now, but you know, up to this point, so you know, I show you some of the results that we use ray tracing to fit to CRJ star data. And we also look at the variability. So, and we can actually come up with some understanding. So the origin of this variability, they can come from the turbulent fluctuation of the accretion flow itself. They can come from the magnetic reconnection of this flux tube. And they can also come from just, you know, showing up of your strong magnetic flux tube themselves. And you know, once in a while, you will see this strong gravitational lensing of the flux tube that gives you these very coherent rings. But you know, if you look at the flux itself, this ring actually doesn't increase the flux too much. And for this model, there's no X-ray flare you know, at all. So using ray tracing itself, we can already learn a lot about the astrophysics of black hole, and we can you know, place, I would say, constraints on what kind of models we can use to model this accretion flow. Now, the problem of X-ray, it can actually be resolved by adding non-thermal electrons. So something I forgot to mention earlier is all the models I showed you earlier, they assume the plasma is fully thermalized. There's no non-thermal electrons. But in reality, for saturated star, the plasma is collisionless. So you, no matter what electron acceleration mechanism you have, once you accelerate the electron, it's very difficult for them to thermalize with this with the system. So it's quite likely that there will be non-thermal electrons in the accretion flow. And once you add those into the emission model, then you can start to see fluctuation even in the X-ray. Okay, so I guess this is another reason why ray tracing is so powerful. You know, again, we are just using some very simple physical argument, but by passing through this physics assumption through the ray tracing, we're able to produce something that we can directly compare with observation, and then we can conclude why the non-thermal electrons are very important in the accretion flow. And you know, the model can even capture some other features that people saw in observation. So this is work done by David Ball. He just graduated from University of Arizona earlier. So his model shows once you have the non-thermal electrons, now you can have flares, you know, this sudden rise of flux in both the infrared and X-ray, and they actually correlate with each other. And this is very similar to what we see in observations of saturated star. Okay, so let's see. We got a question about quantum computing. That's something I'm super interested in, but unfortunately, I'm totally locked up with EHT workload, so I'm not able to work on that. So I'll just pass on that question. And then we have another question about what is the difference between the picture above and picture below? Okay, so I think that is a question on this image. So you know, thanks for asking that. So for all of this movie, the top panel there, the image showed in linear scale. So in reality, if you look at the image in linear scale, you can't really see much in the radial image. But if you plot that in the log scale, then all of a sudden this, you know, the funnel become very visible. Okay, so so thanks for the question. Okay, so we get another question on how machine learning can help in those simulations. So this is also very interesting, and I will say the EHT is actually actively working on using machine learning to help simulations. So you know, there are really multiple routes here. So all of the simulations that I show people so far, they are physics-driven simulations. So you need to start with the GLMHD simulation that Charles showed earlier. And then you need to pass them through the ray tracing calculation. The ray tracing is actually pretty fast, especially if you can do GPU, but the GRMHD is very expensive. And for a lot of application in the EHT, especially when we want to develop imaging reconstruction algorithm, we actually don't need to get all the physics well. And in fact, being able to turning on and off of different property of this simulation is very useful when we design image reconstruction algorithm. So your Charles group and also some other member of the imaging working group of the EHT, we're actually developing, some people use deep learning, some people are just doing noise modeling and use stochastic differential equation, trying to come up with very simple way to generate image. But again, because these images are not physics based, so I will say they are most useful for designing image reconstruction algorithm instead of learning the physics of black hole. Okay, so I think I have to say the limitation of all the things that we have done. And in fact, in the EHT paper 5 itself, there's a quote you're saying that the high temperature collisionless plasma, they must be understood in order for us to understand the physics. So right now, you know, many of these are just assumptions. For example, we assume the electrons, they can cool efficiently so that this collisionless plasma around Sage, they are two temperature, and then we need to assume some electron ion temperature ratio in order to do the model. You know, we need to make some assumption of how we accelerate the electrons. And then we also need to make assumption about the electron distribution function. And in fact, the difference between David's work and then the movie I showed you earlier is mainly about if you want to put long thermal electrons in the distribution function. So many of these, there are active research being done on this, and Elia is going to tell us in a later webinar. But for the EHT's purpose, right now this is an input of our ray tracing calculation, and you know, a lot more work needs to be done on these fields. Another limitation is actually something that Charles also mentioned 2 weeks ago, is the low density region in the accretion flow simulation. So to overcome numerical instability, we need to impose density flaw to make the numerical simulation stable. But for the ray tracing side, you know, because of this density flaw, they really introduce artifacts. So we actually need to cut off some region in the accretion flow to remove these artifacts. Now we do test the final image to make sure that our scientific conclusion is insensitive to this cutoff, but these are indeed limitation, and it would be very good if there are people who can work out numerical schemes to overcome these difficulties. So I end up spending too much time on all the exciting science we can do with ray tracing. And I don't have much time on the upcoming work. So let me just go through this very quickly. Although ray tracing is relatively simple, because they connect the theory and observation, I think working on them is very fruitful and very important, especially because the EHT is bringing us horizon scale image. So this is a list of possible work and related topic on ray tracing. For example, people can improve code optimization beyond CUDA. So we can use more different kind of hardware to accelerate our calculation. We can come up with better methods to handle the coordinate singularity. So we don't need to do the tricky thing of going through the pole. And then we can improve the geodesic solver so that we can more easily come up with developing numerical method for metric beyond the current metric to do tests of long GR theory of gravity. And because this ray tracing technique I'm describing, they're not just for photon, you can actually apply them to particles as well. And so it will be very good to develop some numerical scheme to integrate this particle for very long term, so that you can use them for plasma simulations, for SPH type of calculation. All right, so in this limited time, let me just go through some of the recent work that is done in our group, in the PIA group, to address these two things. The first thing is actually addressed in the second version of G-Ray, that we move from using CUDA to OpenCL. So now the code is actually usable on not just NVIDIA GPU, but also AMD GPU, and also almost CPUs. And then we also switch our coordinate system. So instead of using the standard Boyer-Lindquist coordinate, we are now using the Cartesian Kerr-Shield coordinate. Now the reason for that is because the coordinates Kerr-Shield, so there's no coordinate singularity at the pole, and Kerr-Shield actually doesn't have coordinate singularity at the UN horizon. So in terms of the numeric, this is very good, very handy. And I should also mention many GL-MHD codes, they are also using Kerr-Shield coordinate. So switching to Kerr-Shield gives us a more easy mapping between the ray tracing and GRMHD. Okay, so there's a question in the Q&A. What are the factors on which the resolution of the ray trace image depends? Can we arbitrarily choose the number of rays, or it depends on some other factors? So so in principle, you can just refine your rays as much as you want to accommodate the physics you want to do. So there is a recent paper again from the EHT team describing this high order rings that you may see in the black hole shadow. So you can use you can put a lot of rays to resolve those rings. And the two limitation is really just the computation resource that you need to put in, and also the numerical accuracy of your geodesic integrator. So I would imagine if you want to resolve those very high order rings, then you can no longer use single precision flow and you have to go to double precision. And also there are recent technique that use adaptive ray tracing. I believe there is a recent paper by George Wong from Charles Group that the algorithm is able to refine on the ring to get very high resolution near the at the place that you want that. Yeah, so that's a very good question. So let's see. So for GRRT, I just mentioned that we are switching to Kerschel. So at the beginning, it may look like a bad idea because the Kerschel has more computation in the formulation. But it turns out that because the formulation is very, very uniform, it's actually good for modern computers. And by just some mathematical manipulation, you can rewrite the geodesic equation in a form that is very friendly to GPUs. And again, I don't have time to go through the details and go through the tests, but I will just highlight after you do the hard work to transform the geodesic equation into a GPU friendly way, you can actually make the Kerschel algorithm faster than the Boyer-Lindquist algorithm. So this is just a table of benchmark. I'm happy to share this slide so people can look at these numbers later on. Another very interesting development I want to highlight is a code called Fantasy that is developed by Pierre Christian. So this is a code purely written in Python. The focus is not performance, but easy of use. And there are two main ingredients in it. One ingredient is the algorithm is symplectic. So what that means is it preserves certain geometric property of the system. So what I'm pointing here, this is a test on u.u. So that quantity should remain zero in the algorithm. And you can see after many, many steps, the error is still bad. So this is a property of a symplectic integrator. And this will be extremely useful when we want to do SPH type of calculation or doing direct electron integrations and ion integration in Kerr space time. Another very interesting piece of Fantasy is you use a numerical technique called AutoDev. So AutoDev is very popular in machine learning. We had a question on machine learning earlier. So this is something between finite inferencing and between symbolic computation. So AutoDev, every number you input to AutoDev, you actually, the computer check it as two different numbers and it propagate the chain rule for you automatically. So you can compute all the derivative just by inputting the matrix. So by combining this, Fantasy allow you to just give it a metric. It can be Kerr, it can be other GR solution, and then it will integrate the geodesic for you. So this is extremely useful when you want to development, when you want to look at the black hole shadows and all that. Okay. In my list, I mentioned polarized radiative transfer. So let me just mention that this is also a very important topic because the EHT actually observe polarized radio wave. So there are multiple people in the EHT collaboration who are doing polarized radius transfer. So Jason Dester, Monica, Thomas, and also Ben, you know, these are just a couple examples that people can look up. You know, many of these codes are open source, so you can just, you know, look into the code and figure out how things are done. Another important issue is scattering that myself do not do. But you know, it is important when you try to model the full spectrum of black hole, because the physics here is the electron themselves can actually upscatter the radiation and create a bomb in the spectral energy distribution. So the tools that the EHT use GRRT, there's a Monte Carlo weighted active transfer code developed by Charles Group. And there is a modification of that called K-Monte that include on thermal electrons. And also Ramesh Narayan, they have a short characteristic version of the methods. I'm not aware of any long characteristic method, but it would be very interesting if people can develop on that. You know, some more recent work, these are two students at the University of Arizona. So Tyler is working on integrating charged particles using your auto techniques that I mentioned to you. And Gabriela is doing you know, particle integration in dynamic space-time. So now you can compute the electromagnetic counterpart of your gravitational wave. Okay, so this is all I have. You're sorry for this, it's taking too long. I guess the summary is your GR ray tracing is the interface of the physics and observation. And it's more important than ever because of the EHT is bringing us horizon scale black hole image. The two main components here, they are the geodesic integration and the radiative transfer. Now, the numerical method themselves are pretty well established. And they're actually the foundation of many other numerical techniques that I showed you earlier, including Monte Carlo radiative transfer, SPH type of calculation. So they are very, very useful. And in addition of that, ray tracing, we are also connecting the gravity side and the astrophysics side, and also the plasma physics side of black hole physics. And I think this is a great time to work on black hole. Okay, so thank you, everyone. Okay. The last thing I will put up is a survey. Charles, you can mention that.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, CK. So the survey link is in the chat, and it'll also be available online. We did have a question from Sarab in the chat. How better can we compare the ray trace model images with that of with EHT data? Which is an excellent question.
Yeah, so I will. You know, maybe Charles, you can also help me respond to that. But you know, we have multiple comparison pipeline. I guess the thing I'm describing today, this is the forward modeling part, where we start with the physical assumption and then we do the GRMHD calculation and then we derive the image. And then on top of the image, that now we can start to do mock observation, where we can actually simulate how the EHT will observe such an image. And then we can compute the visibility data, Kosher phase, and all the different quantity that the EHT can measure. So at some level, we can do the comparison at the raw EHT data stage. But another route is because EHT is also doing image reconstruction. So what we can, you know, the other way to do that is we just convolve the image with a kernel that match the EHT resolution. And then we just cross-correlate the simulated image with the reconstruct image. So I don't know if that is a good enough answer.
I think that's a great answer. Yeah, so it's the statistical problem of the comparison is really challenging. But you know, I think CK outlined the mechanics of it. So we're at 1 p.m. and Rosie, I believe we can stay on and answer some questions a little bit longer. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay, so let's continue to answer questions, but that's officially the end of the webinar. All right.
Yeah, okay. So let me just thank everyone for joining the webinar, and I hope you get something out of that. And please fill out the survey. That is very useful for us to improve the webinar. So let me look at the question. So I think that there's a question on, is a vacuum real or is it a concept? So that is a difficult question for me, because all the things that I mentioned here, these are just classical physics, right? So we assume general relativity or even other theory of gravity, we are at the classical level. And then based on the metric, we solve the fluid dynamics on top of that, that is also classical. And then we do the ray tracing, that is also classical. Now we can, in principle, capture some quantum mechanics effect in the emissivity, but that is very far away from pair production or Hawking radiation type of problem. Now, however, at the pole of this accretion flow, we do expect the density is very low. And how you can load the jet, that is actually a very important question. And there are people studying pair production in that regime. I think this is the best I can respond to that. And then the second question is, what GPU computing power are lead to efficiently compute the ray tracing? Now, again, the ray tracing part is a very small piece compared to GLMHD. So with the G-ray code, so that is the code based on CUDA, we are able to compute a single image in 3 seconds, and the resolution is 512 square. So it's very small, but things do add up. So the science results I showed you earlier, the big data fitting that I show, that study actually contained millions image in the quiescent state fitting. And then once we got the model, we also compute the full movie of the simulation. So once you put in all this uncertainty and prescription in the plasma physics, the parameter space become very big. And when you want to go through this parameter survey, then we start to require large computation power. So I will say most of our simulation is done on a GPU cluster in Arizona. So I will say a mid-scale GPU cluster can do a survey like that in a day. But as our parameter space grow bigger, then of course we will need to do even larger survey. Okay, so there are more questions coming in. Can you please mention more about the long-term metrics in ray tracing? Is there a good perspective on distinguish between various gravity theory with ray tracing with compared with observational data? So I would say that is something that we are trying to do. And in fact, for the recent PLL paper from the EHT, some of that result is actually done through ray tracing. It was actually developed by Liam Medeiros. And it's a lot of work because you can imagine this non-curve metric, they have a lot, they have many, many terms. So manually programming them into a ray tracing algorithm and then finding out where the shadow is, there is a lot of work. I don't think we have done that in computing the image yet, partially because the difficulty of implementing this metric. But fantasy, so the Python code developed by Pierre, actually gives us a very good path forward for that. Because using AutoDiff, we don't need to implement the geodesic equation ourselves. You just need to give you a metric and the algorithm will derive all the derivative for you, and then you can integrate the geodesics. So I actually encourage people to look into putting AutoDiff into their ray tracing calculations so that people can easily include different metrics in their calculation. But actually this problem is harder than what I just said, because what I just described is only the ray tracing part of the problem, but you do need to have a fluid model to self-consistently compute a metric like that. So I think Yusuke, again, an EHT member, he has done some work on doing GRMHT simulation with long-term metric. But in general, there is a very challenging problem. Okay, so let's see. Do the simulation consider chaos in the flux distribution and intensity? I'm not sure which chaos this question is referring to. But if you are talking about the turbulence of the accretion flow, then yes, the ray tracing take into account of that by the emissivity, because the emissivity and also the absorption coefficient, they're function of the fluid parameter. So when you have chaos, when you have turbulence in the accretion flow, those will be encoded in the emissivity, and then they will be included in the ray tracing calculation. Now, however, I guess this may not be the chaos that that the nonlinear dynamic people are thinking about. I think this is a good news because your turbulence, they are actually self-similar. So even though the nature is chaotic, if you look at the statistic of turbulence, you can still describe your steady state and all of that. So it actually makes sense to look at, for example, mean of the image and using those to compare with observations. Okay, any more questions?
Okay, well, if there are no further questions, then I'd like to close things out and thank CK again for a very nice presentation. So thank you, CK.
And thanks for everyone for attending.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.